There are problems in our country. Yes, we live in troubled times. There are far too many criminals and far too many crimes. I'm locking every window and I'm bolting every door. The tool I use in self-defense will even up the score. You can rant, you can rave, you can make your demands, and you can take my gun from my cold dead hands. There are global corporations, they have billions that they pay to the greedy politicians who make sure things go their way. They tax us into poverty and we live from day to day. To them we're useless eaters, we don't get to have a say. You wanna crash this constitution? Is that what's in your plan? You can take my gun from my cold dead hand. In every case through history, when genocide was planned, the firearms were gathered up and the opposition banned. The tyrants made distractions and the people looked away. And by the time they realized, they couldn't get away. The smiling face on my TV says, we should all join hands and help create this vision of a new world order plan. We'll downsize our defenses, give our bases all away to a UN global peace force, and we'll do just what they say. Take your globalist agenda and your
new world order
plans, and you can take my gun from my cold dead hands.
I just want to say one thing quick. That is that everybody's made a joke about communism. Communism, centralization, command and control, it's a sweet academic name for that, is a movement of the economic elite to create levers of control for societies through large centralized governments. It is not a movement of the downtrodden masses. And it's well proven to anybody that knows history that international bankers financed the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia. They created and tried to murder the prince of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire and actually succeeded to create World War I. And that's how they create their power, is through destroying society so that they can come out on top. That's basically called despotic leadership, my friends. And what we're going to talk about is a local issue about Roland Ellingson being given $2,000 a day fines for having 3-inch grass. And then you'll see the hypocrisy of a city council member who goes along with this type of absolutely fascist behavior, command and control behavior, fascist, communist, it's all the same. And what you're about to see will shock and anger you to see the hypocrisy. You'll also see the health department engaged in just absolutely hypocritical and ridiculous behavior. But this is only on a local level. Internationally, they have these so-called environmentalist laws where they're going to move all our production to third world nations that have no environmental controls, and I assure you that's not going to help the environment. That is going to hurt the environment. So it's not about the environment. It's not about keeping your neighborhoods good and safe, like the statesman said. It's about controlling civilizations. It's about deindustrializing the U.S. and transferring all modes of production to third world nations with absolutely no human rights, no environmental controls, with the bankers and the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, and the International Bank of Settlements have absolute control and domination.
Now, let me just preface this, folks. I'm going to briefly, first off, I've got a Webster's Dictionary. This is straight out of Webster's. This is not theory. This is out of Webster's Dictionary. There was a system in place back in between the 9th and the 15th century called feudalism. And I believe, folks, if you really take a hard look at it, you will find that this is very similar to the property taxes of today.
Communism is the new pseudo-political term for feudalism to get us all off track and argue about it. It's slavery, basically.
Let me just read what feudalism is according to Webster's Dictionary. A political and economic system of Europe from the 9th to the 15th century, and we're going to put it up on the TV here for you to look at, based on the relation of lord to vassal as a result of land being held on condition of homage and service. Now, basically, well, if we ever get to it, maybe we're not going to get to it, but that's basically what it means to, and I want to just also, while they're working on that, I want to read to you
some of the planks of communism.
Now, here in America, let's read this. Here in America today, we Americans pride ourselves as being supposedly staunch anti-communists.
But we got to pay our fair share.
Right. Communism is a way of life that is contrary to most teachings of the Bible and that of common law as our beloved country was founded on. In 1848, Karl Marx wrote the 10 planks of the Communist Manifesto, which he copied from an article written by Zionist and Illuminati founder Adam Weishaupt in 1787. Now, this is the feudalism from Webster's Dictionary. You can see that. That's very, like I say, this is basically you don't own your land. It's an illusion of ownership. You're actually renting your land that you believe you own.
And you know, Jeff, if we were all ants and bees, this would work just fine. The problem is in one of these systems, corrupt individuals always foster this system so that they can have an excuse politically to control your destiny and your life. And remember, again, communism is a movement of the economic elite, not of the downtrodden masses.
Okay, the first plank of Karl Marx's Communist Manifesto is the abolition of private property and application in the land in the hands of the state. Basically, it reads here, as in the old law of Moses and in the first 150 years of America, remember, this wasn't always here, when you own your land, you had absolute title to the land and no other party can lay claim to it.
A person's home is their castle.
Right. Today, we have what we call a 99-year lease. The state can confiscate your land for non-payment of taxes. So this is plank one of the Communist Manifesto. Plank two, we're going to be getting into more of that. This also deals with permits, land fees, having your land declared a floodplain.
Now, Jeff, I want to back up.
Let me just mention floodplains, property taxes, permits, all these UN takeovers, all the different ways that the government or some form of government is controlling your property. Well, go ahead, Alex.
Well,
you
I just
comment
wanna,
on that.
I
one.
Just want to say that this is a local manifestation. What we're seeing under the guise of environment, and it has nothing to do with the environment, it has everything to do with revenue generation.
Right.
And
the key term in all of the understanding.
Yes,
all of this.
Yes. And the secret to the whole thing of it is that taxes ought to be on what you consume, like a sales tax or something like that. They should not be on your home.
Before 1913, the national government was founded strictly on tariffs and trade.
Yes.
Most people have no conception of that.
Well, that's how every other successful country runs their trade, and it creates thriving economies. Now we're a huge debtor nation because of the income tax and the unelected, unaccountable IRS. There's no innocent until proven guilty. There's no due process, something very simple like due process with the IRS. That just doesn't exist. And
we're going to get into that. Well, before you do that, let me just read this, because you led right into plank number two. Second plank of Karl Marx's Communist Manifesto, a heavy progressive or graduated income tax. We all know that we have an income tax in America, and the more you make, the more you are taxed. The income tax on the working individual was instituted in 1942 by the president of the New York Federal Reserve Bank, Mr. Beardsley Rummel, with the backing of FDR.
Now, I want to back up for a second. People probably heard that the more you make, the more you pay. That's up to about 200, 300 grand. If you're a Rockefeller or a DuPont, you got to be in these super trusts that got knocked out about 1903. They got to grandfather their trust to where they get to keep all their wealth, put them into trust and foundations, and then their wealth only grows. In fact, when a Rockefeller dies, they die worth nothing. Their wealth goes to their family. When a normal person dies with $100,000 in a home, the state gets about half of it.
Plus, many of these people have hidden assets in Swiss banks and all this, which we will never
know. That's
why they never show up on the
Forbes.
The Forbes 10 most wealthy individuals, because their assets are hidden.
That's, yeah, if you believe Bill Gates, worth $26 billion, is the richest man in the world,
you've got some ice cream to sell people in and the North Pole.
Exactly.
Okay, now plank number three, folks. The third plank, the abolition of all right of inheritance.
Actually, I got some mining stock.
Okay. The abolition of all right of inheritance. Now, this is in the old law of Moses.
That's for us, not for them.
Old law of Moses, in the first 150 years of America, there was no inheritance tax. In the law of Moses, land was transferred to the eldest son absolutely. In the first 150 years in America, inheritance and your assigns was also absolute. There was no third parties involved. A marriage license makes the state a third party to the marriage. If you are an alien, you cannot have right of descent. Thus, the state has an interest which must be paid when one dies.
Mike tells us that we got to go to the video, but I can just do a quick recap of what you're about to see. This was the big talk for several months from KLBJ to KVET to my radio program on 98.9 KJFK. There was a lot of discussion of this. It's very important, and this is absolute feudalism. This is local land grab.
Well, I understand. I want you to explain this just before. I'm still going to get through these quickly. I won't read all the deals here, but
yeah,
I want
to. Mike's demanding to go to the video.
The fourth plank of the Communist Manifesto: the confiscation of property of all immigrants and rebels. And we're going to. And this tape will illustrate this. Some people, SWAT teams, whatnot. Businesses are closed. Homes are closed.
See a close up.
Okay. So we're actually seeing. Okay. Now number five. Communist Manifesto. This now we're going to need a close-up of this.
This is who makes sure you pay right here.
All right, that's who makes sure. Now, number five, centralization of credit in the hands of the state by means of a national bank with state capital and exclusive
monopoly.
But
remember, these are controlled, though, by the transnationals who are bigger than any one country.
Right, but right here, folks, is a good example. Well, actually, let me
if you're for communism, you're for the ultra-corrupt rich.
Let me do this. Right there, if we can get a real good, can you focus in on that, or is that, this is where your tax dollars go. Right there it is. That's your national bank here in America. Well, tell us a little, just briefly about that.
Well, it's a gigantic money trust established in 1913. And for their full slavery to be enforced now for 84 years, they have to totally destroy private property under the guise of environmentalism or this or that.
Okay, let me go to plank number six. I'm going to get through these planks, even if we have to cut out some of this later stuff. Okay, number six, the centralization of the means of communication and transportation in the hands of the state.
That's part of the thumb
scanning. Now, this is accomplished by the Federal Communications Commission, which controls, regulates, and licenses all newspapers, magazines, radio, and television stations.
Local,
who
national
are in
networks.
In a corporate capacity. Transportation is controlled through the use of state vehicle registration and licensing of the owner.
And now they want to thumb scan you. They've been doing it since 93, and now Clinton wants urine and blood testing for everyone to get licensed.
Oh, it's all loving. Plank number seven of the Communist Manifesto: the extension of factories and the instruments of production owned by the state, and the bringing into cultivation of land and the improvement of soil generally in accordance with a common plan.
That's the UN land grab and control.
That's
the guise of it's total control of society. Let's go there.
Well, let me just mention this. The factories are controlled. Okay, this various agencies that control this are OSHA, labor boards, unions. Smaller businesses are extensions of these factories because they are franchises. So, but for some of the various governmental agencies like the Soil Conservation Districts, Bureau of Land Management, Desert Land Entry Act, where government-owned land is leased to corporate farmers,
like the Imperial Valley. And now with H.R. 901, Executive Order 12,986, this is trying to counter that. It makes the UN a super government over our controls. And this is happening. And anyone that denies it is just an absolute idiot.
Eighth plank. I'm going to get through them. Equal liability for all to labor and the establishment of industrial armies, especially for agriculture. Equal liability is established through Social Security, and forcing women to work to support the family, as men cannot earn enough to support the family due to the debt usury money system. Most are members of the industrial
army. And then the children have to be educated by the state and be prostituted to the state.
Right. Most are members of an industrial army through this number. Because you cannot get a job without the number. This is your Social Security number and other things like this.
Thumb scanning.
This would also involved certain labor. Probably,
get number 9 and 10.
Well, let me just mention, probably things like affirmative action, forcing employers to hire certain things, or certain people, all these types of things. Number 9, the combination of agriculture with manufacturing industries and the gradual abolition of the distribution of population over the country. Regional government, and this is the explanation for it, regional government under control of the federal government, who are under the direct control of foreign bankers. In other words, one world government. That's number nine.
And the last is free education.
Yeah, number nine. I don't need to explain this.
And it's not free.
Tenth plank of the communist education. That's true. Free education for all children in public schools.
Government training and indoctrination centers.
Even private and church schools must obtain a license and teach a state-approved courses.
Jeff, we got to go to this video.
I just want to read this real quick. Teach all humanistic principles, not reading, writing, and mathematics. They are taught to be good slaves to the government and ask for a license, permission, before doing anything.
Okay.
With that, folks, go ahead and explain the...
The story you're about to see was big time on all the talk radio, a huge story. The Statesman actually countered our piece. And attacked it and said it was for the kids and to keep us from crime. 3-inch grass, he was given $2,000 a day fines. He's going to court this month. Total hypocrisy. You're going to see the hypocrisy with city council members and the actual health department that issued the $2,000 a day fines.
Let me just mention this quickly. I want to just read it because this is very significant. 10th plank Communist Manifesto. Free public education, like you said, which isn't free. In fact, 6th and 7th graders are taught to fill out income tax forms by the IRS. They are taught that the government will support them if they do what they are told and do not ask questions.
Yeah, don't ask questions. That's bad.
Okay, let's go to the video.
Here we are at a council member's house, home. Not a home. Here we are at a council member's house, home, down here in Austin. And I'm not going to tell you their address or who they are, but you ought to see how overgrown their house is. I mean, this is just ridiculous. Very nice little neighborhood over there, I will tell you. But it's just crazy. We'll just wait till you see how overgrown it is. Hell, look at that house. That's more overgrown. Look, that's not the council member's house, but look, that's more overgrown than Mr. Ellingson's. It's crazy. I think it makes me the maddest is how the paper countered with that story. We came out and did a story about Mr. Ellingson being harassed by the health department and environmental services, and 2 days later there was a front page thing on the health department saying how wonderful they are stopping crime, sewage, and helping the children in East Austin. Everything health department did it. Here we are, folks, the right-wing evil. Look at it. This is a council member. Now, we should probably slap up some footage later of Mr. Ellingson's and show you that this is 10 times more overgrown than his property. Selective enforcement. Selective enforcement. And we're not attacking this council member. We're just saying, hey, maybe they should know about the hypocrisy in the city that they run, that we've elected them to protect us from their own minions. Even the driveway's overgrown. I mean, look at that. And folks, the camera can't even catch what's going on in this yard. And it's not our business. We don't care. I don't think it's a problem. But the Statesman does. The health department does. They agree $2,000 a day fines for noncompliance. Better take their home. Better bulldoze it. Out of control. Out of control. It's best. Absolutely out of control. I gotta go up there. Well... anyways, we went out there, and I don't know how to explain it. You should have seen it with your own eyes. The council member owns two houses on that street. The one you're looking at right now is supposedly where the neighbors told us she lived, and that's where the hot tip told us she lived, and then we checked it out, and that is where the council member lives. And we asked five different neighbors. They all said, oh, yes, the council member lives there. Then they pointed us to the rent property across the street. I don't mean to laugh, but it looks like you'd see a great macaw parrot or something flying through, or Tarzan. It's unbelievable. Totally overgrown. You can't even see the front door. And it's a nice neighborhood. You can see the neighborhood there. I mean, she definitely has the worst properties in that neighborhood. We drove around a few streets, and it was just unbelievable. It seems like bureaucrats are all the same. I mean, they'll tell us how to do everything. When you go look at them, they're slobs. And I'm not knocking a zero-scape yard. But in a few minutes, we'll show you Ellington's property. The guy that got they threatened him for $2,000 a day fines. Now look at that. She owns that property. That's the rent house across the street. Holes in the roof. They have a tarp over it. You can't see how the wood's rotting. And I wish we would have got a bigger camera shot of the entire property. There must be a little trail to the door. It's unbelievable. And you'll probably see me laughing and making a joke out of it right here. But I mean, And I'm saying leave her alone. Leave the council member alone. But if this doesn't make us act, if this doesn't make us... Now, there's her actual property where she lives. And the camera just does not catch it. Unbelievable. And the air was just swimming with mosquitoes. I was being bit on the head and on the back of my neck and on my hands. When I was over at Mr. Ellington's house for about an hour and a half talking to him last week, we first did a story. There was nothing. There was no bugs. He had healthy cats. Didn't see him scratching. Had a beagle dog. He's an old, retired, semi-retired arborist. I try to make jokes out of it and make it to where we can handle it, but really, it's scary. And then to see the Osmerican Statesman, 2 days after we did the story Monday, on Thursday, because we did it Monday night, so really that's two business days, come out with a front page story on the cover saying, tall weeds cause crime, East Austin, all these buzzwords. No, it's $2,000 a day, folks. They love it. They're making tons of money out of this. Squeezing people with environmental services. Tell you the truth, it's not good for the environment to, there's one of the vehicles that's parked there. You might want to, and you can guess who the council member is. We're allowed to say who the council member is, but I'm not going to get into that game. But again, there's the rental property across the street, the neighbors told us, and the other property is where she lives. And again, they have a rotting roof. Why, that's a health hazard. Standing water, just like there was lots of standing water, just like the letter that Mr. Ellington got said, remove objectionable material. Well, what's that? I don't know. Whatever they want it to be, I guess. But we'll show you some cuts of Mr. Ellington's property. Now, this is a normal, what most of the houses look like in the neighborhood. And then there's her yard next door to one of the other houses. So there's one of your council members again, folks, showing us how to run things. Broken down vehicles. We didn't want to get on her property, but you could see the vines were wrapped around the antenna on the vehicle. Don't you attack me, Alex Jones, for what I'm sitting here doing. I'm not trying to cause a bunch of trouble for this person. I'm saying they're running our city and they're going around harassing people, and then it's just hypocrisy, man. Ellington. And then people called the show last week and called my radio show too and said, we got to cut that grass. It's for them, hurting, crime, bugs, breeding. And I'm like, he had 3-inch grass. Oh, the city wouldn't do it unless it was needed. Well, all right then. If Ellington's land's bad, then get over their city and put liens against her. $2,000 a day. Their own, last Thursday's Osmerican Statesman had it in there. $2,000 a day is needed. It's important to keep us safe. Yeah, safe from what, I don't know. I'm not going to ramble anymore. Here's Mr. Ellington's house. Check this out. And see the difference between her properties and the council member's properties and his property, where he's lived since 1947. Here's his property there, and he did nothing to it. That's exactly how it was. I drove by 3 or 4 days before we did the story and saw it, and the grass was uncut, unwatered. It was like 3 inches high and had dead spots in it, like any other, place with a lot of trees. And the place was well painted, nice indoors. I didn't see a tarp on the roof or anything, a danger to any children or anything. And the house you see in front's where he has some renters, some nice English guys who are artists who live over here. And then you can see Mr. Ellington, older gentleman's arborist work shed. And there's some of his evil right-wing cats. Those are actually his cats. And he's got a dog. And he's also got a parrot back in his two-story little house in the back. Lived there since 47. Actually built those houses himself. His wife died. So that's what's going on. Actually, his wife died, so moved out of that house a long time ago and rented it. Kind of sad to live there. And you can just see the problems that he's been causing. It's obvious that he's bad. And you can see there's the arborist, a little trailer. They give him a little bit of trouble about keeping that there. See, maybe he was just like Goodman and became a... I'm sorry. Maybe if he was just like some of the people in government around town, nothing would happen to him. Maybe he would just be left alone. I don't know. Maybe he'd just be left alone if he'd just give up and quit working and not have that bad trailer with some plants in the back, that he has to go pay the landfill to exorbitant prices to dump. And here's the backyard, just the complete evil. You can see some lumber where he does a little bit of carpentry, and he didn't even straighten up when we came over. That's just the way it's been. There's the terrible long grass. just the worst thing I've ever seen. It was a little bit taller in back. It was probably 4.5 inches tall in back. And see, we're not hiding anything. We're showing you the back. And those tarps were not put up just because we came out there. He'd had tarps over his lumber for a long time. There was holes in the corner of the tarps. They'd been there so long. And there's his vehicle. You know, just a bad man trying to live his life. There he is. God, he's got to be stopped. Oh, man. And there we go up front, being bad people, you know, just causing trouble, hurting whoever we can. And in a few minutes, I'll show you the health department. We went out to the health department after we were here, and as usual, didn't even go check it out before we did the story. We just went out there to the health department, and it was just in disrepair. And there's the letter he got on July 17th. We were on the story by the 25th, and by the 26th, and the Statesman had countered by the 31st. With a story about how, you know, it was all East Austin, it was all crime, it was all broken sewage, every buzzword they could think of. And then it showed some couch at a, but there's the little citation, threatening liens on his house and $2,000 a day fines, which they do routinely. I'm here with Charles Roland Ellington, over here in central Austin, right off Guadalupe Street. And he lives at 407B West 37th Street, Austin, Texas, 78705. And thank God people like him are still willing to stand up. Now, I was shocked when I met Mr. Ellington at a Patriot meeting talking about lower taxes and less government regulation, you know, bad things like that. And later he faxed me some information that the city is harassing him, the Austin Health and Human Services, Travis County Health Department, Environmental Health Services Division. They have piles of junk in their backyard. We went in his backyard, and there's nothing but a stack of lumber covered with a tarp. This is his private property. This is America, and I want you to film the grass here. There's nothing wrong with this grass. It's xeriscape grass. That's what the environmentalists beg us to do. It's cut. It's clean. There's no problem. It's you know, it's not some millionaire's home, but it's a nice central Austin home that I would be proud to live in. I really like the way these neighborhoods look. So that's what we're talking about today. We're talking about how there is selective enforcement. And then I was shocked to find out that Mr. Ellington, Mr. Charles Roland Ellington, has in the past gotten onto the city about some of its out-of-control spending and has been an involved citizen. And so that's something that I find to be very shocking. Mr. Ellington?
Ellington's son.
I really appreciate you having the will to stand up to what they're doing. How did this all start, and in your opinion, why are they doing this?
And if you'll note that the expansion in the blue pages will give you the blues by the volume of increasing phone numbers supplied for city services. Services.
That means harassment extortion centers.
That's about the size of the matter.
So you exercised your constitutional right, you've gone to city council, you've written letters, you've made phone calls, and now you're being singled out and being harassed for no reason.
That does seem to be, cause and effect, reason, it does seem to be prudent.
Well, we're not going to invade the privacy of inside your home, but I was just inside there with you. It's a very nice place, no big deal, almost like a little country house. How long have you lived here?
Since May of 1947.
How dare you, you evil carpetbagger. We've got to get you under control.
Well, it's before this city usurpation of micromanagement, the cockroach syndrome. The cockroach syndrome of micromanaging all facets of a citizen's life. And that's not American. That is un-American.
Well, how dare you be a hard-working arborist and a person that's engaged in other... I mean, that's just... How dare you?
A bourgeois member. A member of the bourgeoisie.
That's right. Yeah, you're out of control. We've got to stop you. We've got to... this little loving letter right here, I'll just read part of it. Austin Health and Human Services, Travis County Health Department, Environmental Human Services. That's gangsters calling themselves service agents. 15th Waller Street, Austin, Texas, 78702. If you want to get in touch with them, we'll put up their number during the show. You want to call and tell them how much you appreciate them harassing older, hardworking citizens here in town. Their phone number is 469 469-
469-2015. That's 469-2015. And their fax is 469-2030. And we'll give that out later. Now, it says, this is an inform you that a condition in violation of ordinance or state law exists on property located at 407 West 37th Street. And you've said you're a tough guy, you're willing, you don't mind people knowing where you live. If they want to come by and see the evil property that you live on, see, I came by before you, when you first faxed me this. And you told me that since then you raked up a few leaves, that's all you've done to straighten up the property. And it's still shocking to me. It's your property. That's not the argument. You should be able to do what you want on your property unless you've signed a homeowner's clause. And as far as I know, over here on 37th, there is no homeowner's clause, is there?
To my knowledge, I don't recall of one.
So the footage you saw at the first was when we went out to a well-known council person that's been reelected, and they had a tarp on the roof, vines, grass everywhere, mosquitoes flying around, 15 times worse than his, Mr. Ellingson's property. Now I'm going to show you the footage that we went and got that Monday of the health department. And again, we didn't go check this out at first. We just went right out to the health department and checked it out, and they were worse. So what we found is all these bureaucrats that are out telling us how to live, they're all 10 times worse than the most average home in Central Austin on West 37th. So stay tuned for this, and then in a few minutes we'll be back to the main program.
Hi, Mr. Ellington. I could see that you've lived here, what, since 1947, you said?
May of that year.
May of 1947. And look at these nice trees. It's pretty.
Real small when I first came.
Yeah, and there's pretty English ivy growing here in the trees, and you've got a nice shield around your tree over there to keep it healthy. Boy, you're a right winger. And I saw your pretty little cats earlier. I could see why the city really, really wants to get its hands on this property like they've done countless others.
Make a parking lot out of it, perhaps.
Oh, yeah, or, you know, get some rent from, from a good liberal lawyer or something.
Yes.
Well, we were leaving Mr. Ellingson's place in less than 150 feet from where he lives, right in the middle of the street, some giant potholes. There's some behind us and some in front of us. Let's drive up here back and look at them. See, the city won't even wipe its own nose, but it'll abuse older people in town and force them, terrorize them into giving them more money for their bureaucrat behavior. See, all the money is going for bureaucrat salaries. It's not going to actually do the work of the city. Now they have to force us to do everything. Here, let's see the loving pothole. Here we are, just right down the road again, and look, they're telling him to mow his yard when his grass is 3 inches high and he hasn't mowed it. When this kind of stuff's going on, about a 6-inch deep pothole, and there's more down here. So ask yourselves, what kind of country is this? Well, that's the truth of it. All they do is harass the citizens, push the people around. We're losing more and more of our personal rights, and they're making despotic inroads into private property, while at the same time not taking care of the essential services. You see, they dangle essential services in front of your head. Oh, you want the potholes filled. Oh, you want the EMS to have radios, don't you? See, they pay for the essentials last and pay for all their greed and strange bureaucratic behavior first. This isn't an attack at your average bureaucrats, government workers. I'm talking about the people that are under the control of our federal government that want to pay homage to them. Here we are at the loving, caring city. Austin Health and Human Services, Travis County Health Department, Environmental Health Services Division, down here on 15th Waller Street. And look at all the weeds over there. Look, it's worse than, much, much worse than Mr. Ellingson's ever was. By that air conditioner, look, that's 6-inch grass. Oh, I'm going to take the city building if it doesn't fix it. We'll have to put a lien against the city building for Mr. Charles Ellingson. Oh, and look at that tree. Look at those weeds right here, producer. Oh, my gosh. Oh, this is just the worst. Oh, my gosh. Now, folks, I know this seems really stupid, doesn't it? What is the big deal about weeds growing, much less on somebody's private property? Oh, yes, the city's being well taken care of. Look how nice the city buildings are. Boy. Always built nice. You can always trust government buildings to be built nice. Yes, I don't see any flowers growing like there are at Mr. Ellingson's. Here we are, 15th Waller Street, at the health building. Yes, this is where little terrorist activities are launched from in abusing the citizens of Austin, people that pay for their homes like Mr. Ellingson, who's had his home since 1947, owns his home outright. They can't stand that. Look at it. But it's this power. Look at those bureaucrat notebooks and things up there. Think of all the wonderful harassment that goes out of this little mobster building.
Words and pictures can't describe. You have to be out there at the health department and just see how run down and messed up it was, with trash on the ground and thousands of cigarette butts and weeds growing up everywhere and walls falling down. It was just really depressing. And again, from council members to the health department that does the citations, $2,000 a day for not having your grass cut if it's over 3 inches. It's out of control. It's hypocrisy. And something scary about that letter was it said objectionable material. Well, I mean, they had trash all over the place and cans laying around the ground and just piles of cigarette butts and diseased-looking birds hopping around. I mean, that's not, and I don't, nobody's faulting them. Why are they faulting, you know? And then the paper comes in after we did that story and comes in defending the health department. They're shaking people down, man. They're shaking them down, plain and simple. Just to recap, there's Ellingson's house. And there's the council member's house.
Now, folks, get ready to see one of the most amazing stories in Austin's history. This house right here belongs to Mr. Joe Capanna, a veteran of World War II and Korea. The city threatened to bulldoze Mr. Capanna's house on a Monday. But we were there on Saturday interviewing some of the neighbors and talking to Mr. Joe Capanna. And by Saturday night, Alex was on the radio asking for volunteers to build Mr. Joe Capanna a new house on Sunday. Of course, about 60 people from Alex's radio show showed up on 49th Street to build Mr. Joe Capanna a new home. Then, thanks to KI News, they were talking about it on Sunday. Then you had hundreds of people and businesses participate in the building of Mr. Joe Capanna a new home. This is why I'd like to name this story Miracle on 49th Street.
We're here on East 49th Street and we're talking to some of the neighbors of Joe Capanna. Alex Owen and
Aaron Benfield.
And Aaron Benfield, thanks for talking to us. And we tried to talk to some of the other neighbors. I guess they're gone or don't want to speak to us. Mr. Capanna next door, what type of neighbor has he been in the past?
Well, you don't hear from him very much because he keeps to himself, but he's been a pretty good neighbor. No complaints from us.
Yeah, he's never said anything. He's never called any complaints against us. We've always had a couple parties, and he's never really done anything about it. He's been a really nice neighbor. He definitely keeps to himself, like Alex said.
Front yard's cut, and the house isn't attractive, but it doesn't bother me.
Well, it's his property, and it's better than him being out on the streets freezing to death or panhandling or even worse, engaged in criminal activity.
Of course. He doesn't bother anybody, and I don't see why we should bother him.
Mr. Benfield, do you have a problem with this gentleman living next door to you? He has lived there since the mid-1950s. Do you think he's causing a problem?
No, not at all. I mean, I've only been here for 6 months, but I've been coming over to this house since this guy's lived here, the other roommate, and that's 2-3 years. And I've never heard anything bad about this guy. I don't have a problem with him at all.
Why do you think the city's planning to bulldoze his home?
Because his house is, I guess it appears ugly to people, and I really think the problem is that the neighbor on the other side is selling his house, and I bet that kind of deflates the price of his house that he wants to sell it for. Just because something looks bad, it's going to make the property next door look, depreciate in value. And it's just not right.
So ruin somebody's life, tear down a veteran, a disabled person's home just so they can get more cash.
Exactly. Somebody that fought in the war for this country, and you're going to come and tear his house down in the country he fought for? That's just ridiculous.
That's not America.
No, that doesn't sound...
And some neighbors don't want this person to live here. They don't want this house here. They find it to be an embarrassment, they say, and of course they won't talk to us on camera. Of course nobody's volunteered to help him. They'd rather just put him on the street and then spend 10 times the money in welfare to try to take care of him. This is what you get for serving your country. Well, Mr. Capanna's not here right now, but you can see his home. Does have some structural problems, but people, due to property values in this area on East 49th and some of the other homes that are being sold in this area,
have filed complaints with the city, and on Tuesday they're coming out here with bulldozers to destroy this structure. Of course, we haven't heard of any churches or organizations that care to help Mr. Capano, a veteran. We see these movies like Saving Private Ryan or The Thin Red Line, showing you the plight of soldiers in World War II, but no, not Mr. Capano. They'd rather make him homeless, throw him out, and then let the social welfare net take care of him. Probably cost 10 times over time what it would cost to simply fix this structure. If we can get in touch with Mr. Capano, we will come out here and help shore up his home, no matter what the cost, right here at the Freedom Report. So what do y'all think about Mr. Joe Capano's, what do y'all think about Mr. Capano's home here that's going to be torn down Tuesday by the bulldozers?
I really think that it's a shame that it seems to be a crime to not be wealthy. You know, I'm sure he's going to make a great parking lot or a great house for maybe Paige Gressett, who knows?
it's really bad. It's one thing that people have, I think, kind of lost sight of is that it's his property. Simply. It's his, he owns it, he can do what he wants with it. Or at least should be able to.
I've got some land in Oklahoma, and my grandfather gave it to me because I was the only one. He sat me down. He said, don't ever, ever get government's help. Don't ever ask for government programs for anything for the land. They'll try. Don't. Because once they get on your land, they'll find something that's endangered, or they'll find something that's wrong, and they'll try to get it. And he's seen it happen, you know, a lot of rural land. He's seen that happen, and so that's why he gave it to me.
It's all for loving reasons, of course.
Yeah.
So y'all think that Mr. Capano should be left alone? We've been trying to talk to him, but he's obviously...
He's scared, probably.
But what we're trying to find out is we've got some churches and some organizations that are ready. The company that I work with on the side, Mountain View Homes, we're ready to come in here and fix the house and put a roof on it. If the city will just back off.
I tell you what, I'd be willing to help, and I'd get some local comics.
I guarantee you there's people that are ready to help. I mean, you guys were just driving by and wanted to help. So you kind of summed it up in a nutshell, didn't you? It's his property.
Yeah, well, it's, back in the early history of our country, it seemed more like where, you know, if you own your land, you could do whatever the heck you wanted with it as long as you didn't bother anybody else.
We're here talking to Joe Campana. How long have you lived here, sir, on East 49th Street?
Since 1959.
Since 1959, and you were in World War II and Korea?
Yes.
And you have 100% disability from the government?
Yes. Disabled.
Now, you say, and I'm glad that you came out to talk to us, so I want to thank you for that. You're saying that the city's been harassing you for 20 years?
Yes, they have, since 77, about the matter. And it's here under other, and it has to prove injury before other can be overridden by the city. It's been out of their jurisdiction all that time, and they've been offending constitutional provisions every time they find me about the matter. And now they seize my property, took it falsely.
They've seized your property?
Oh, yes, my cars and my shielding and everything in the backyard, thousands of dollars worth of equipment, and even the lumber to do.
Well, your neighbors told us that you used to have some cars that weren't even in bad shape, had the glass, the tires, everything on them. They said the city came and took everything that you own.
Yes, they took everything in the yard out.
Yes, when did they do this?
Well, they should have taken what they caused in the back room when the roof caved in out and repaired it. But
they caused the roof to cave in.
Yes, the city. Bill Steele, I believe, pulled the eaves off of my house. Now, he may have had help. It's all in the report I've turned into the city. And here it comes again. The last time we talked to him about this matter, they said, we're not going to do that anymore because they knew they were illegal. And the lawyer, the attorney general, the FBI, and several other people, they gave me reference to call. I called them. Now, here it's all happening over again. And they said they weren't going to do that anymore. I'm trying to get legal help. The lawyers don't want to come out here I don't know why. I can't go there. I have everything delivered here.
You don't have a car because they took your cars.
It's not the car. It's, I have my, this is embarrassing. My prostates are enlarged because I'm 73 years old, and I have to urinate frequently and go to the bathroom, have access to the
No, I understand. I understand. That's a common problem. So they've been harassing you for 20 years. You've lived here since 1959, and now they've seized your property by saying that you caused damage to others, but nobody else lives there. This is your property.
I haven't caused damage to anyone or harm to anyone. They had to prove harm because it's here under other from county court. It's over their head. The damage they caused and complaining about, they caused. And if there's any violations of that, they're the cause of the violations, not me. But I'm the one that's being punished and made look bad over the matter.
Now, who is the person that sent you the letter who caused the damage?
The city council, building people.
Inspectors?
Yeah. They're the ones who, I have a whole C-ration box of vertical envelopes from them for the past 20 years.
Is there any way, we don't want to...
Over the same matter.
Is there any way that you can bring that out and just show us a few of the documents?
Sure. Sure.
Let's do that. And so this is the letters you've gotten over the past 20 years from the city.
Yeah, maybe a few minus, but mostly.
This is incredible. Can I look at some of the earlier ones?
You can look at all of them. Here's some. They're all about the same. I mean, you can. And
this is incredible. This is from the city of Austin. Going back 20 years, and you lived here over 20 years before that.
I've been here 40 years.
Nice. 40 years. And this is your rights in court, and this is the case.
Yeah, same case.
And there you have it. This particular one goes way back to 86, and they're fining you, and it's talking about the tickets and the status. This is just horrible, but you've beaten them every time over 20 years.
I haven't beaten them. There's been four acquittals and four guilties, I think, but guilties are invalid. They can't stand because of the first acquittal.
We're going to get with some citizens. I assure you, we're not just blowing smoke at you. We're going to come out here, and we're going to fix this to our best ability to keep the elements out since the city tore your roof off.
That was fine. Just enough to get the city off my back about it.
And it'll probably be hard to satisfy them. If you've been fighting it for 20 years, and here's the evidence, right here, just a mass of letters. In fact, might get a shot of this. Going back over 20 years, they've obviously got it out for you, sir.
And, the bias.
And so I certainly hope that we can fix this to their specifications, but I think that we're going to be able to do that. We can prop up those walls from the inside and put a new roof on for you, and we'll do the best job we can, okay?
Yes, I appreciate that. If the city pays me what they owe me, I can pay you from that.
No, we don't want that. We're not taking a dime from you, sir. Now, what does the city owe you?
Well, they owe me the fines they fined me plus the interest on them, which would be the true value of the money, since. And they did that when I was getting 12% from First Texas, which isn't in business anymore.
How did they destroy your roof? That's interesting.
They pulled the eaves off the ends of the rafters. They must have threw something over. Pulled every one of them off they could pull off.
Why on earth would the city inspectors come here and pull the eaves off your structure, the corner points?
Well, but again, you said there must have been bias toward me. Bill Steele says, when I won my car situation, and the trailer situation, he pulled eaves off of my house. And he said, after I get your cars, I'm going to get your trailer. And I told him not to push any one man too far.
Was this over the telephone?
No, this was here in person. He had another lady with him.
What's his name one more time, the man that threatened a World War II and Korean veteran?
Bill Steele. He was a building inspector then. I don't know whether he still is or not.
Bill Steele.
Right.
Why on earth would a building inspector vandalize your property?
Well, now, he shouldn't have done that. He should have told me about it so I could have done something about it.
Oh, excuse me. He trespassed on your private property and tore your eaves off?
Oh, that's what it adds up to, yes.
You know, with the airport moving, your property is going to be worth a lot more.
Well, it is, and I have mineral rights, and you can't get those somewhere else. And I own this property. I know it's not in a tornado path. I don't want to move. They're telling me that I don't have any place to move to, but I really don't want to move. I want to stay here.
Sir, don't you worry. You just found the friends you need. We hate government. We hate big government. We fight big government. We're going to fix this house. There'll be a bunch of people out here Tuesday. If the bulldozers try, I'm going to jail. We're going to stop them. We're going to fix this house, most of it, support the walls by Tuesday. Then we'll put another roof on here for you. Well, we talked to your neighbors, and most of your neighbors seem to like you. Some neighbors wouldn't talk to us, but your next-door neighbors say you're very quiet and never complained about them.
That's true. I don't bother anyone. I've never harmed anyone. I mind my own business. I say hello, you know, and I'm friendly.
Where were you in World War II? What part of Europe, or was it the
I was in the European theater of operation. I have two invasions of Cherbourg, the second one and the fourth one. I could have been killed in the first one. They pulled us out, grabbed me under my arms and lifted me back on the bar.
You were actually involved in D-Day.
Oh, yeah. Well, it wasn't D-Day, Cherbourg. It was after D-Day, but it was along the coast. Cherbourg was the last one along the coast. You know, Normandy was first. Le Havre, they call it. And Cherbourg was the last. It's the whole coastline of France. It was across the channel. It was the D-Day invasion is when it was. And that's where I was.
And you've minded your own business for 40 years here and for 20 years. And here's the evidence right here. They've been harassing you.
Right. You got the story right.
And now they destroyed your roof on purpose. Well, this is just incredible. This is exactly what I'm talking about. Sick control freaks out here in our society want control of your life. We're going to fix this and show government what real help is. Not destroying a veteran's home who's got 100% disability. It's just sickening activity. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
And we'll be out here tomorrow and Monday doing some basic repairs, shoring up the walls and some other things. We may even have to tear out that wall there, but I promise you, we will fix it. For those that know me, I assure you, you have Alex Jones's word, we're going to stop the city.
All right.
I have to go to jail.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
A community pulls together to help build a new life for an Austin war vet.
Good evening, I'm Lisa Monzo, and welcome to CAD Witness News Weekend. A World War II and Korea veteran may lose his home of 40 years come Monday. The city of Austin plans to tear it down because Joe Campana's Central Austin house is falling down. Julie Gerscher shows us that because of our story last night, he may be getting some help.
I got all turned up inside with anxiety about the matter.
In fact, war veteran Joe Campana has been so upset lately, he drinks Pepto-Bismol right from the bottle.
I don't want to move.
But the city of Austin says he must, and notified him they will bulldoze his home Monday.
Because I haven't done any harm to anyone. And it's not my negligence. I'm doing my best to manage, and it's about all I can do is to go on the way I'm going on.
We first told you about Campana's flight Friday. Some viewers were so upset when they saw our story, they decided to help.
If this house is unsafe, we need to make it safe. And I'm going to donate materials and the employees to do it.
Mountain View Homes, a building company, checked out the house. They decided it couldn't be saved. Instead, they will build him a new two-room home on the same land.
We need churches. We need volunteers. I'm going to donate all my employees.
At first, Campana was skeptical.
Is that a scheme or a catch, or are they, how can they do that?
Mike Hansen says his help is for real.
My grandfather fought in World War II. I'm a veteran myself. I want to help this man.
All Joe Campana wants is to keep calling 618 East 49th Street home. With your eye on Austin, I'm Julie Gersha.
An owner with Mountain View Homes admits they will be violating city permit regulations, but he says giving Campana a home before the bulldozers show up is much more important. Good evening, I'm Lisa Monzo, and welcome to CAD Witness News Weekend. Joe Campana's house was about to be torn down, and he could not do anything but watch. Some Austinites who saw Campana's story stepped in, and tonight, the war veteran has new hope for his future. Julie Gersha has the story of strangers reaching out to help an elderly man in need.
Because it's the right thing to do.
Saw it on the news last night, figured they needed some help.
Right.
Essentially having a house-raising party.
They came out in force. To drive home their point,
don't want the guy to be homeless.
Their efforts brought tears to this World War II veteran's eyes.
It's not manly to show tears, but it almost brings me to tears. But you people care.
2 nights ago, KI told you how Joe Campana would lose his home to city bulldozers. By Sunday...
It's incredible. The appliances have been donated. I mean, we have walls going up.
Most of the people out here rarely pick up a hammer and nail. But Joe Campagna's story brought out at least 50 volunteers to make sure he has a roof over his head.
This encouraged me and give me hope and courage. And this moved me.
The roof he lives under now is about to fall down. And the city has deemed the old house unsafe with demolition scheduled for Tuesday.
This is a floor plan for the new house.
But with some luck and a few more donations, there'll be a new house waiting for Joe Campana.
I'd like to thank you for making us free.
A man who many feel deserves the gratitude of all Americans.
I see it kind of just as an old-fashioned barn raising.
I'm eternally grateful.
An Austin man accepts help before his walls come tumbling down.
Good evening, I'm Neil Speltz. Christy Fletcher's off tonight. You know, this was supposed to be an Austin man's last night in his home of 40 years. The city planned to bulldoze Joe Campana's house because it was falling down. But after our stories of the past few days, some Austin volunteers stepped in, and KI's Pamela Cathion is going to show you what happened next.
Dozens of complete strangers hammer, saw, and drill in his front yard. Joe Campana is the disabled veteran KI showed you Friday. He lives in a home where walls cave in and part of the roof is missing. Neighbors complained, and the city planned to bulldoze the home. They said it was just too dangerous to live in.
I have no place to go.
Then the weekend came, and so did help. By Sunday, Campana had almost 100 volunteers working on his property, building him a new home. Volunteers so anxious to help, they started without a city building permit.
We had some naysayers out here saying, don't do it, you're going to go to jail, and these people kept digging.
The city's plan was to do a final inspection on Monday, then have Campana's house bulldozed down Tuesday. But thanks to some hard-working volunteers, things have changed.
Monday, the city gave volunteers a permit, postponed demolition, and approved building plans.
The floor plan itself is more like just a small studio or an efficiency apartment. It'll have a kitchen on one side, a living area, and a sleeping area in the back. It's just such an absolute marvel to see the people that have come out to essentially build a house for someone that no one knows.
I owe them a debt, and I can't work to repay it, but I can donate to repay it.
These workers don't want anything in return. They just want to help.
I'm exhausted. Ready?
Yeah.
Fire away. Lance, you've been out here all day slaving away. People have just been donating everything from the entire electrical systems, doors, windows, thousands of dollars of lumber. How does it feel to see...
Awesome. This is the best thing. I'm so glad that we seized this opportunity to help Joe get his place in order. I can't believe that that the city's not out here getting behind us and supporting us. You know, more than these are all volunteers. These aren't any city people out here. And but it's great that we're taking this opportunity to do this for him. Guy served in World War II, and this is long overdue. That's how
and
I feel
about
it.
You hope the city doesn't bulldoze it.
No, no, I don't want to see this place bulldozed. No, no, we don't want to let that happen.
That's
no,
right.
I think that would be a disgrace. That'd be a shame to do that to this man's property. He doesn't want to leave. He just wants a decent place to live. He doesn't want his house bulldozed. He wants to stay right here. And I think we owe him that. And that's just how I feel about it. And I'm glad to have this opportunity to be here to help him.
Hey, thank you very much, buddy.
Thank you.
Hey, Brian, does it feel good to be involved in something like this?
Yeah, it feels real good. I think... It really shows how the American spirit hasn't gone. You know, it hasn't really left. There's still some good people in this country. And to see this old man who's fought in the war, in World War II, one of the biggest, you know, for us to come out here and help him is really great, you know.
And that they treat prisoners with more respect and care more about their rights and their concerns and their health issues than people that are retired and disabled and veterans of foreign wars. It's ridiculous.
You have to remember, criminals are important to wreak havoc Yeah, that's part of order out of chaos.
You know, if they'd lock them up instead of letting them go, we wouldn't have the problems we have today, and we wouldn't need this huge police force. It's all an excuse. I mean, they let convicted murderers out. They go and kill again, and they're surprised. It's ridiculous.
And at the same time, nonviolent people are spending more time.
And people that are in there for nonviolent offenses, the three strikes thing for like small-time drug dealers, I mean, you know, if the government wouldn't bring the drugs in, there wouldn't be a problem.
Great point, sir. Thank you. Let's go talk to Lewis. Councilmember Lewis, good to see you again. Good to have lunch with you. Hey, we appreciate you coming out and supporting us in what we're doing and hoping to get him out of that dangerous structure and get him into this new one.
Yeah, well, that's the same thing the city tried to do before, and you know he refused to let him build one before some time ago. I don't know exactly when, but people are taking this opportunity to help their neighbors.
He has a letter that he actually was offered that, and then it seems that that person that offered it to him from the city was no longer there.
Well, I don't know. I wasn't there.
I understand you're a new council member. Well, thanks for coming out. Does it make you feel good to see all these folks out here?
They said it was about 40 out here. I talked to 42 today, and they said it was about 42 people out here earlier. I mean, about 40 people or so earlier.
Oh, we've had about over 100 since 8 o'clock this morning. Yeah. A lot of folks had to go.
Yeah.
Well, have you seen all the lumber we've got?
Yeah, he just gave me a tour of it, and he was explaining to me what the process that they're going to do next week. So, yeah. We'll get started on getting a permit in the morning. So.
God bless you, sir. Thank you very much. All right. Well, that's Councilmember Lewis doing the decent thing. There were like 100 people here over the day or over.
Right. I mean, just everybody from church groups to people in the building trades to just anybody who felt that they could meet.
You know, I'm just glad it happened.
Right. How do you think it's all going to play out?
It only has one way to go, and that's up. So, you know, I mean, I don't see anything that would play out any different. So, I mean, they're going to apply for a permit in the morning, and it shouldn't take, but, you know, I mean, it should be something that would be done. The inspectors come out, and people be able to go on. You know? This is a situation that can require some deviation. You know, I mean, you're not going to spend the 6 weeks or 2 months or whatever going through the permit process. So, you know, I think it'll play out to everyone's benefit and everyone's hope and desires. So, now, you know, I've been working with the Travis County Veterans Affairs.
Yep.
So, you know, me being a veteran, you know, I have some.
Was a lot of veterans here today.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's what I understand. I was talking to Susan from Channel 42, and she said it was quite a few. And I expect as soon as the word get out, it'll be a lot more.
Yeah, yeah. Now, as we break here for a second, let the plane go over.
Yeah. And the good thing, it's only about 3 or 4 more
that's
months.
That's right,
you know,
15 but, weeks.
Yeah,
15
yeah.
weeks.
100
the
some days, and these planes won't be doing this no more.
I think they keep it open for a small airplane.
No.
Completely closed.
No more airplanes. No.
Well,
Yeah.
Now, sir, can we ask you, how do you feel about all this activity in your front yard today?
Nothing like this ever happened to me before in my life, and I am so proud of you people being real Americans and showing what you believe is right and you are right about the matter, right?
Come on, let's get the microphone there.
Now, sir, you lived here how many years?
40 years.
40 years.
Year. I moved here in 1959, and this is 1999.
Now, your house is a little run down, could use a few repairs, but it looks like they're going to build you in a brand new house in your front yard. Is that your understanding?
That's what they're doing, and they're doing it so rapidly, I didn't know they could do it that fast.
And what will happen to the house you're living in right now, sir?
Well, I want to save it as long as any aircraft are flying over.
Okay.
I might not need it so bad if there aren't any more aircraft.
Well,
but I could still use it for storage, and it'd give me more room to have a hobby and something. But it's no danger to anyone else. It's false, it's exaggeration, it's hyperbole, No one has been harmed in 20 years that I've lived.
Are you glad that the bulldozers have been stopped for the time being?
Boy, do I. Yes, I do. If this is the most encouraging thing I've heard, that they're not going to destroy it now, I hope.
Now, yesterday on KI, you acted a little bit surprised and said, is this for real?
Why don't you let the plane roll over? Hold on 1 second, sir. Let the plane go over.
Yesterday on KI, you were a little bit skeptic about what me and Mike came out and told you, weren't you?
Yes. I don't know what was up.
Now you've got a house half built and all the fixtures and doors and windows and electrics.
I'm astounded by it, right?
Amazing, right? We're going to crush the New World Order.
You guys are great, right?
Now, you had mentioned you wanted to keep this house up as long as the airplanes keep flying over. You are aware that this airport, Robert Miller Airport, is going to completely close down
in
15 weeks. You're going to put state office building out there, and there won't be any airplanes flying over this neighborhood in about 15 weeks.
Well, that'll improve the value of the property.
Yes. Right. In fact, some people were thinking that because the property value is going up, that they're interested in your property.
We had people here today running off with plans, telling us we better not build, and now the council member comes out, they say it's fine, we're allowed to do this, and we're doing it according to permits. That's what I said this morning, Jim. Is that we've constructed it, we've built it, but we haven't poured the concrete. We've got all the basics ready to go, the foundation ready to go, all the superstructure built, and now it's just like assembling a Lego set. Mm-hmm. All it takes is the permits, and we're go.
And of course, you have no interest in leaving your home of 40 years, right?
I don't want to leave here. I like it here. I know the climate's mild, and it's not in a hurricane path. And it's a safe place to live, except the city has aggravated me for 20 years about this matter.
And he has 20 years of documents, he'll show you, Jim, and KLBJ.
Right. You can understand that, I think.
Yeah. Well, I live just one block away, and had seen your house for many years, and was a little concerned, I could use a little fixing up, but I could see why you wouldn't want your home bulldozed and be run out. And I have to say, I'm equally amazed at this construction and the speed of it and the number of people. It's really a groundswell.
Look what numbers can do when 100 people working on it. Look in one day how much you've got accomplished.
Well, we've got to thank KI, and we've got to thank all these people that showed up.
Yes, I wish to express my eternal gratitude, and I don't know how to say it other than that. But if you have a charity, I'm going to contribute to it.
I don't have a charity. Alex Jones and Mike Hansen and Steve Lane just want to get out here and help you.
Well,
and at the same time, showing there's decent people out there, all these veterans, all these families, men, women, children, out here working.
That's it.
You're going to have a new house by Sunday if the city doesn't come in here and bulldoze what we're doing. If they give us the permits, and Willie Lewis has agreed, so we're going forward. If you can just get the rest of the council to back off.
See, it's over here or what?
Yeah, for the time being.
All right, I'm going to sing a little song right now, and I'm going to play it on this guitar that was given to me by Mr. Joe Campana. I love it. It's a little Sears of Roebuck. It's my new favorite guitar.
How old is that guitar?
Older than me, probably.
Yeah.
Come and listen to the story about a man named Joe. The city council said, Joe, your house has got to go. KI News put the story on their show, and out came the black helicopter people. The kooks, that is. The so-called anti-government right-wing conspiracy nuts. The call went out for to save Joe's home. The SOS was shouted out by Mr. Alex Jones. Patriots came and they did all they could do to help to save this hero of World War II. The big one, that is. Joe was a junior in high school with a farm exclusion and an only child exclusion when they drafted him and tested the atomic bomb on him. Next thing you know, old Joe's yard was filled with friendly volunteers and materials to build. They said, we're gonna help you, and you will not have to leave your silver painted trailer or the comforts you need. The
comforts of home, you see. Whatever they may be, they're private property, a man's castle, or supposed to be. And now it's time to say a thanks to Joe and all his friends. And we would like to thank you folks for kindly pitching in. And thanks for coming out for barbecue that Saturday to have a heaping helping of our hospitality. American hospitality, that is. It was all made and born in the USA, just like our new American hero, Mr. Joe Campana.
Austin Vet is moving into his new home today. KI has followed Austin volunteers as they help build new dreams for Joe Campana. KI's Julie Gersa joins us live from Campana's home in central Austin. Julie, how's it look out there?
Mark, it looks really good. Now this you're looking at is the old home at 618 East 49th. This is how it all started. Joe Campana, a disabled World War II and Korea vet, has been here for more than 40 years. But the city had told him a couple of years ago he was going to have to move because they said that this home was unsafe. Well, when people saw this story on KI and later heard about it on a radio talk show and cable show, they decided they weren't going to stand by and let this happen. So hundreds of volunteers have donated their time and their money, appliances, the siding you see on the house, and this is what Austinites who care built. And today, Joe Campana had his big moment.
Joe, hope you enjoy your new house.
Thank you. Yeah.
Joe got the keys to the home today. It is a modest cottage, but this place is furnished from top to bottom. They've donated furniture, everything in here, all down to the little details. Now, we talked to Joe about this gift that Austinites have given him because they care so much about him. And he was very moved by what they did for him.
I'm overwhelmed. It is the greatest thing that's ever happened to me that I can recall.
And Mark, in case you wanted to know what it looked like inside, here it is, fully furnished. Some volunteers have been working on this for a long time. They just happen to be in here watching. They are, can hear the cheers from outside. They're very tired. This has been, they did this in 13 days, a city record. Councilman Lewis said it was a record the time that they got the permits, but they wanted to make sure that they beat the bulldozers, and Mark, they did.
All right, Julie, that's a fantastic story. Way to have the community get together in such a short period of time. All right.
Mr. Joe Campana's house, and I guess you can see behind me, we've got a front end loader from a demolition company, and they're going to scoop up Joe's old house and cart it off. Of course, we got big thunderstorms coming through, maybe an omen of things to come here. We're out here for the unconstitutional demolition of Mr. Joe Campana's old house, so we'll get it all on videotape and hope you enjoy what we do to our elderly in Austin. And they're going to put a lien on the place for that, so we'll have to get that taken care of. Oh, they said they were going to donate the demolition. The guy wasn't going to charge.
And they shouldn't put it. They shouldn't put it.
Well, maybe they won't. These are developing facts all the time, folks. They may or may not put a lien on Joe's house. Anyway, Joe ought to be left alone in peace, but that's a part of smart growth in Austin. A lot this size, you can put about five row houses on. So welcome to smart growth.
And it was by deliberation from the county court. It was here under other, and it causes jeopardy, and they had to prove injury, and there is no injury. There hasn't been any. They're claiming the house is a very dangerous place. It isn't. It's been the same way for 28 years. I shored it up. It shored it up so well. It hasn't deteriorated in all that time beyond the deterioration it has. But the damages here were caused by the city, and they've been arresting me and fining me and even usurping my property over the matter. And it's time for this stuff to get settled properly and stop this criminal, illegal practice this city seems to think it has a right to indulge in when it doesn't. And
how long have you lived here, Joe?
I've lived here since 1959. That makes it 40 years.
How many houses were on this block when you moved here, Joe?
What was that, Lance?
How many other houses were on this block when you moved here?
Oh, I don't know, about the same number, I guess, except the one next door built an upstairs to it, and it's modified. It's been about the same all those years. But the property is becoming more valuable because the airport's going to move out to Bergstrom. And I think the city's after the land. And I think if they thought they could get away with it, they'd go on doing it. Because when the lawyer called him, he says, we got caught. Like they were doing something they thought they could get away with, so they got caught, and then he said they couldn't.
We don't get on film.
This is Joe's home. And this is lights
this
out.
This is it. Yeah, this home. Is the last time you'll see it, Tony, say that.
And wishing people were out front. We cleaned out everything that we could. Man's got a lifetime in here. He's lived like this for 25 years. The house being in this state of disrepair. This is his home. They have a right to live like this. Dug a bomb shelter in the middle of the floor, excavated underneath the house.
So the slab collapsed.
Now we're pulling the cord. We've got a bulldozer walking up the driveway. Here in the background. Joe, we love you, buddy. We did what we could.
Here comes a front end loader to tear it down. Your house would be next. Yeah, maybe you think, oh, the hell with old Joe, but here it is, live and in color. Here it is, ladies and gentlemen. This is the teeth of the government here, the teeth of the government ready to knock down Joe's house. It's a dark day. We got the severe thunderstorm warning in. I wonder if this is an omen of things to come. We did manage to move everything out of the house. Mike and Lance and Scott and others came to move it out. Not quite as many people as when we were building it, but it's not much fun here. Anyway, we'll get more pictures when the teeth of the government takes its first bite of Joe. Yeah, we've got a close-up of the flag flying over Joe Capanna's house. I don't know if the operators have noticed it, but it'll go down with the rubble. And of course, we know the flag's been trampled on by Clinton administration, this city council, and others. So it's nothing new to disgrace the American flag. Joe's a World War II veteran, and the front end loader is about to take a bite out of Joe's freedom, and yours too, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, here's Joe talking with the demolition fellows and a few of the people that came out to help. That's Tony. He did the tile work in Joe's new house. And Gail, she's been helping all last couple of days moving stuff out of Joe's house. Difficult thing to do, but somebody had to do it. Joe couldn't do it. Joe hadn't had but like 2 hours sleep the whole day. You know, I guess if they were going to knock your house down, you probably wouldn't get much sleep either. Anyway, it's going to happen shortly. Fitting that we're fixing to have a big, giant thunderstorm with damaging winds and large hail across the street. We got the bureaucrats. They're just drooling while watching this process go on. I'm glad it's not my life's work to demolish a World War II veteran's home and enjoy it. Anyway, we're fixing to The winds changed out of the north in the last 15 minutes, and we're going to see a pretty good storm. So God's watching old Joe, and Joe's got courage, and we're just going to tell the government to go to hell, and we're going to go after him after this is all over with. So here goes the teeth of government fixing to take its first bite at Joe's house. They took down quite a few of my campaign signs. Here it goes, Liberty Teeth there for Joe Campana. We're just following orders out here. Boy, look, the whole thing rocked. Get a picture of it. Now the flag is still flying. Yeah, let's back up. We'll get the whole thing on tape here. Pretty sad. There it goes. The whole house shook when it took a first bite of Joe's house here. So the rain has let up a little bit for this event. It's just kind of speechless, you know. I feel like the guy when the Hindenburg blew up, he was pretty excited. But we're watching him knock it down now. How long has Joe lived here? For like 50 years, 40 years. And they're knocking it down mainly because the neighbors didn't like the looks of it. Even if Joe stayed in it, and he said it's been pretty much in this shape for the last 20 years anyway. Thing's not affected by right now. Are you still rolling?
Yeah, go
ahead. Okay, Mike's still rolling. I'm trying to get the microphone underneath the umbrella. Mike's under an umbrella now. Here goes. We're going to take another scoop. Another scoop out of freedom. Another scoop out of freedom. Yeah, the flag's still up. Reminds you a little bit of Waco. At least the BATF's not out here. There goes the whole thing. Oh, they're knocking Joe's house out. How's Joe doing in the house?
It's been bad. I wish you had two cameras. One to put on.
Is he in there alone?
He probably doesn't want a damn camera on him. I wouldn't blame him.
Yeah, there goes the Joe's. That used to be Joe's kitchen, and the flag's still standing. Maybe that'll be the last thing to go. These people don't care. And now it's raining like hell. Isn't it interesting that the rain's picked up as the demolition's picked up here? God bless America, and the hell with the salamanders and these salamander lovers that'll spend $26,000 a piece to put in a salamander handrail, but it'll tear down an old man's house. These guys are pieces of crap. People are taking pictures in the background. We don't have any problem with A&R demolition.
They're Christians.
Yeah, what we understand is that they're going to donate their time to this because they realize what's happening. So maybe we'll find $1 million in there. I don't know. Yeah, old Joe's next door in his house. Well, I'm just gonna comment. Oh, I'm ready. People just need to watch it. There goes the whole house is moving. The whole house is shaking. And here comes the flag. Here comes the flag. Whoa, it's still standing. Yeah, look at that. The house has totally fell down, but the flag's still standing. God bless America, land that I love. Yeah, so much. It's free. It's God bless the salamander God. That's our new God, a little blind salamander. Yeah, I bet you city officials, they're frothing at the mouth over this. Yeah, old Joe.
They can put up apartments here.
Yeah, yeah, they can put up at least five row houses. Oh, the flag's still standing.
Good for you.
Yeah, it's raining like hell out here. We got lightning, and we got the neighbors all out to watch them knock down Joe's house. Ladies and gentlemen, is your house next? Wake up! I can't believe we're witnessing this. Just because they don't like the looks of it. I've been in beer joints that look a whole lot worse than Joe's house. Boy, this thing's getting wet out there. Oh, not me. I'm worried about the microphone. Here.
flag's still standing. I hope he don't take it down.
Are you still getting, well, if he does, when they take it down, it's a literal and symbolic gesture that liberty is gone. Okay. Now, look, the rain is at its height now. The rain is at its height.
No!
Oh, there it is. Liberty. Oh, that's the end of liberty. That's raining its worst. Oh! Boy, that's what they think of that flag. That's what they think. No, it worked out good. The rain is at its height. The rain is at its height. The flag is down. And so is Joe's house here. Yeah, I don't, you know, yeah, we believe the house was raggedy, but Joe should have had the right to keep it. It didn't, you notice it hasn't fallen over on his neighbors. It hasn't gotten anything on his neighbors. Joe lived clean in the house, probably cleaner than most of us. He didn't swill beer and booze and smoke cigarettes. Maybe you consider that bad. But he was a clean living, or he still is a clean living man. And he just wanted to be left alone in his own residence. So his residence now is gone, and the water's leaking through onto the microphone there. Whoa! Yeah, there goes the city officials with the neighbor next door. COA, City of Austin, I guess. Maybe we could... Communists of America, maybe. Who knows?
You think we should get that on film?
Yeah.
Tony, well, is Tony with? You zoom in. I'm a little damp here. Rain's picking up again. We just been told that Joe's inside. He feels real bad about this, but we're not gonna lower ourselves like the national news media and stick a camera in Joe's face as they demolish his house. But you might expect he feels bad about it. You'd feel bad. We all feel bad about the whole thing. A lot of us have spent a lot of time and money out here to try to remedy the situation, and the bottom line was, I should have just left Joe alone. And, you know, if the house fell in on Joe and he was in it, that was his wishes. You know, people talk about firemen and fires. They get killed and they say, well, they die doing what they want to do. But and Joe should have been left alone. Yeah. So it looked like it's a tough job here. Here's a big bite of the house there. I guess they got to make a big pile out of it now. Every time they move it around, why, it gets smaller chunks, you know. I guess this is a good video of how to do demolition on a house there. Of course, the occupants didn't want the demolition, but we're getting it anyway. Oh, and threw it in the dirt.
It's a terrible thing what they've done to him. Couldn't they just find something else to do, make better use of their time? This is just absolutely ridiculous. World War II vet, he's been through it all. He owns his own property. He's been here for 20-some-odd years, and they got to take the entire thing down just like that, with no regard, at all.
How's Joe?
Joe's inside playing some music, and he's pretty upset about it.
But this doesn't happen. Not everybody is as lucky as Joe.
Right.
There are people that lose their homes and don't have anything to do. Look out, Joe. They'll mash you there. Joe's trying to rescue one of his ammo boxes.
Keep talking, Big. I want this.
And we hope Joe doesn't get mashed in the process there. They're picking up his stuff. What's that coming out of there? God. Oh, that's something that was in a barrel. That was water in a barrel. Joe's hostile about his ammo boxes.
He's really a calm man. Look at him.
Yeah, you got to give Joe a lot of credit for standing up in the face of the enemy here. We're just
people helping.
Yeah, you know, Lance, who wrote the famous song "Ballad of Joe Capanna."
We'll play that tonight.
And there's Joe digging through his stuff, trying to rescue.
Good stuff.
Look out, Joe, don't cut his hands on that stuff.
All his stuff.
Yeah, he's got these ammo boxes. I don't know what he's got in them there, but he thinks a lot of them. Doesn't matter what he's got in them. They shouldn't knock his stuff down, take his personal property. This is exclusive footage. Nobody in the media came out to videotape this. They'll come out to videotape Governor Bush at a suspected where somebody threatened to do something in a school. They'll come out and make a big news media deal about this, but they won't come down when a World War II veteran's getting his house demolished. However, Channel 42, we got to give them credit for coming out initially, but I think they were probably advised to stay away today. So, anyway, we're out here. We're all soaked in the rain. Anyway, my God, here's some more of Joe's stuff. Man, it's unrecognizable now. I think that was Joe's bed there or something. Here's Joe trying to retrieve something out of there. One man's trash is another man's treasure. I remember my dad used to go around on trash day and pick up television sets and he repaired them. I think, get Joe out of the way.
Get Joe out of the way.
Joe, here they come. Look at Joe. Yeah, he's trying to retrieve some possessions that we couldn't get originally. So we don't want Joe to get mashed. Yeah, here's the treasures of Joe Campana. Some Vaseline jars and some life, what he calls life support stuff. Oh, yeah, Joe was a medic, so
he would have
looked out. There's Kathy in disbelief here. Yeah, Kathy and Tony tiled Joe's, did all the tile work in the new house and worked out here for months trying to help Joe with the recovery of his stuff. And they've been with him through and through from the beginning. So there it is, the big scoop here coming over the corner, trying to get the corner of Joe's house. There. Just an hour ago, we were in there rescuing his stuff. Now it's just so much junk.
Morning. You can get some air time on the
We'll take one of your. I'm gonna get my gloves.
Well, we're standing at the rear of Joe's new house that the volunteers built for him, and a lot of good business people donated all the material for it. You can see in the back. I guess I'm calling it. Now you see it. Now you don't. Joe and friends are looking for some of his stuff that he'd been looking for himself for years. Recovering footlockers with documents in it out here at his house. Hey, here's everybody trying to recover Joe's stuff. It's pretty treacherous down there. I hope nobody gets a nail in their foot. Joe had some documents that he was saving from the atomic test site, trying to get some kind of benefits from being radiated during the hydrogen bomb test. But anyway, we're looking through that. It's kind of reminds me of the tornado in Gerald, where people were trying to recover their belongings. You know, the only difference is here that the tornado here is the government.
Cold dead hands. There are global corporations. They have billions that they pay to the greedy politicians.
You're looking at Nelda Wells Spears, Travis County tax assessor and collector. You will see classic examples of doublespeak, that is, lying, using semantics to shield the behavior that she is engaged in. It is very sad that she passes the buck, number one, and number two, tries to deny the fact that they take property and homes and engage in feudalistic behavior. And then she acts like she doesn't know what I'm talking about when I use many different terms, like feudalism. And I'm sure she must know what feudalism means. I'm sure she's a smart lady. It means slavery. It means you pay a yearly rent to the government for the right to use and live in the home that you paid for. So remember, if you pay for your house and you own it, or you think you own it, you do not truly own it because you pay a yearly rent to the feudal masters. Then we'll get to a property auction approximately 3.5 weeks after we did this interview with Nelda Wells Spears, where she passes the buck. They have auctions for lots, property, businesses, homes, you name it. On Channel 17 on Travis County Television, they show the homes that they foreclose on every year. They're in the back of the newspaper. Then how can she sit here and say she doesn't know what we're talking about? The government should not be able to take your home or your automobile, the things you need to live. This is feudalism. This is terrorism engaged in by every city, county, and state in the United States and the world today. Now here's Nelda Wells Spears, Travis County tax collector and enforcer.
Mrs. Spears. Hi, I'm Alex Jones. I have a question for you.
Okay.
There are a lot of people that are not even considered middle class. They're losing their homes due to property taxes. And we have seen the rates of property taxes go up and up and up, even while people can't sell their home because of the watershed laws. What's your opinion on that?
I really don't have an opinion on that. I wasn't aware that a lot of people are losing their homes.
Oh, nobody's losing their homes?
I didn't say nobody, but not a lot of people.
A lot of people aren't?
No, a lot of people aren't.
How do you feel about making people support public schools where the test scores have dropped from number 150 years ago to number 49th now with their property taxes? Isn't that a form of feudalism?
I haven't the foggiest notion of what you're talking about.
Well, you do tax talk.
Yes, we do.
I mean, I heard everybody congratulating themselves on here about it.
We collect the property taxes for jurisdictions in Travis County, as the Constitution of the state of Texas requires.
Yes,
so I'm probably not the person you need to be talking to.
How many bureaucrats were here today? About 100?
I have no idea.
And they were all being congratulated for the departments going from, I heard one parole officer and truancy officer bragging, they went from 7 to 107?
I don't know what you're talking about. The ceremony in there was for years of service to Travis County.
I understand. How many homes will be lost due to the $13 million overage on the county budget?
I'm not sure that any homes will be lost.
Well, aren't y'all going to have to turn up the heat and squeeze some more people?
We're not squeezing people. We're simply collecting the taxes.
And simply enforcing the law.
Enforcing the law.
Ma'am, I'm not being sarcastic when I say this. Was Martin Luther King bad whenever he went and sat in at the lunch counters and was taken to jail and beaten because it was the law that black people couldn't use water fountains or go in and sit at lunch counters? Or what about when that one lady refused the law because she thought it was wrong and sat at the front of the bus?
What about it?
What about Rosa Parks?
What about her?
Well, you act like all laws are holy and sacred and that nothing's wrong with them. My grandparents have had their house attempted to be stolen. They're over 75 years old. They live in a modest South Austin home. Something's wrong here.
We don't steal anyone's home.
You don't steal homes?
No, we don't.
Y'all don't put liens on homes?
There's a tax lien that is attached at January 1st of every year for every property in the county.
Well, you just heard that. We're not stealing homes, but we do put a lien on everyone's house at the start of each year. Even before it's time to pay, they just have that threat there. They have that sheriff, that constable, standing there at the ready, just like of old, just like in feudal Europe or feudal Japan or feudal China, feudal Russia. Oh, it's always the same. I guess we're not modern at all, are we? We're still slaves of old. It's just high tech now with a pretty face.
5 years old. They live in a modest South Austin home. Something's wrong here.
We don't steal anyone's home.
You don't steal homes?
No, we don't.
Y'all don't put liens on homes?
There's a tax lien that is attached at January 1st of every year for every property in the county.
So you're not stealing homes, I see.
That's correct. We're not stealing homes.
Oh, they're your homes. I see. They haven't paid, so they're your homes.
No.
They're your slaves, aren't they?
No.
Because you're the local viceroy.
I'm none of that. Right. I'm a local tax collector, period.
You're the local tax collector. How do you sleep at night?
Very well, thank you.
You sleep very well knowing the families you've wrecked.
We've not wrecked any families. We've not taken any homes.
You've not taken any homes. That's... You're saying the county's never taken any homes.
I didn't say never.
Oh, you said we haven't taken any homes?
I'm not aware of it.
I've seen y'all listing the homes that have been taken. I've been mailed things in the mail about auctions and homes that are being sold by the hundreds.
Those are not necessarily people's homes where people are living.
What do you mean?
There
are
lots of vacant lots.
No.
They're vacant lots.
I've seen you. This lady right here, she's having her house stolen.
Well, she needs to take it up with someone else.
She has. She's here every week. Every week.
I have a student here.
Okay, last question. You say that you're not selling people's homes. You show the foreclosed homes on TV that you're taking. You've shown them on TV.
You're trying to steal my home now, ma'am.
On Channel 17.
Thank
what about my cameraman? You're trying to steal his house.
Well, he can come to the office and we'll talk about his house.
He can come to the office? Ma'am, hey, we're not some type of evil people. Ma'am, and you said that you said that we're a bunch of conspiracy theorists, Sheriff. You know these helicopters are being used, Sheriff. These helicopters are being used for surveillance. You know they're putting flare on them. You admitted it.
Yes, we're putting flare on.
What about the feds? We stopped the Delta Force. What about the Delta Force, Sheriff?
Jones, and I'd ask that you get the microphone out of my face.
You want the microphone out of your face? I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry for trying to report the news.
And now we switch gears to the steps of the county courthouse 3.5 weeks later after Nelda Wells Spears. And take a look. Yes, I've given it this nightmare effect just to make us all think a little bit about where we are in the country today. Look at all the people out there begging and chaffing and pleading and bidding on property, and the armed guards out there carefully keeping watch. And later you'll see some guards actually bidding on things to get the bids up, a little extra manipulation. Isn't this interesting? But they're not stealing property. Oh, certainly not. It's just very, very saddening to me to see the public out here. This is so archaic. The government says they're interested in our welfare, but they'll actually take your home or your property? Unbelievable. Let's get actually to some of this sickening behavior. Ah, yes. The den of iniquity. The den of fiefdom. Corruption. Power. Backroom deals. Favoritism. Can you imagine what the federal and supernatural levels are like? But look at the people, they just accept this criminality. Close attention to this fella from Parks and Recreation. We'll get to this just a little bit later.
We're going to begin the constable sale now. We're going to begin the constable sale. We're going to start with two lots that are in Briarcliff. This is in cause number 9208940. We're going to start with lot 646. This is going to be lot 646 in Briarcliff, section 15. The location is 402 Stricken Drive. This By virtue of a certain order of sale issued pursuant to a judgment by the District Court of Travis County, Texas, in cause number 9208940, styled Travis County et al. Versus Gina Sue Nelson Brewster et al., and under the authority of Bruce L. Fett Constable of Travis County Precinct 5, I did on June 28, 1998 at 10 a.m. levy upon the following described property located in Travis County as the property of the judgment debtor, Gina Sue Nelson Brewster et al., that being lot 646, Briarcliff Incorporated, section 15, plat number 42/47, as described in volume 8751, page 746 of the deed records of Travis County, Texas. On said property is under no warranties, express or implied. You buy debtor's interest in the property as is. Bidders are further advised that the purchase of the debtor's interest in said property at this sale may not extinguish any liens or security interest on the property. You're only buying whatever interest, if any, the debtor has in the property. Subject, however, to the right of the judgment debtor or any person having an interest in said property to redeem said property or their interest therein at any time within the time prescribed by law from the date the purchaser's deed is filed for the record in the manner provided for by law, subject to any other rights to which anyone is entitled to under the law.
I know that that legalese doesn't sound very exciting, but what you have here is lots and homes and businesses being auctioned off. In fact, the county will even send these out to you monthly if you want the listings. They're in the newspaper, and again, they're on Channel 17. But let's get back to this because the story hasn't even begun yet. But you heard him. The debtors. The judge that took the property, the love. That's what we're dealing with here. Total corruption. Sanctioned by the government. Done by the government.
Briarcliff Incorporated, section 15. The minimum bid is $3,508.91. Do I have an opening bid? I'm sorry, what?
The opening bid, I guess.
Give me the number.
My number, or?
Tell me what you want to bid for the property.
$3,508.91.
$3,508.91.
Tell me, slave.
$3,508.
Slave? Oh, yes, slave. I demand you tell me now. How dare you? How much money for this slave's property? Tell me now.
$3,600.
I'll take 37.
37?
$3,700.
I got a bid of $3,700. I got a bid of $3,700.
$3,800.
Sir, I got a bid of $3,800. Got a bid of $3,800.
I'll take
$3,900. Got a bid of $3,900. Got a bid of $4,000.
I'll do 41.
41?
4100.
I got a bid of $4,100.
The behavior went on incessantly as the bids went up. Now, pay close attention to that fella. Our cameraman, Mike, was busy getting interviews and talking to people during the bidding and filming the main person that was giving the bids from the sheriff's department. But that fella right there from the Parks Service, John Foreman, an eyewitness and one of our associates, saw him getting the bids up from the back of the crowd. And let's go ahead and go to John Foreman and see what he saw there at the auction. Bid rigging, perhaps. Getting the bids up. A lot of shifty behavior going on that day by some of the law enforcement officials from all different branches of the government here in Central Texas. A lot of interesting behavior.
Also bidding here against the property, and he was armed, and I don't know if that's permissible here in Travis County. I thought if you're on duty and you have a firearm, what are you doing down here bidding against citizens for these the theft of these properties? You know, it just doesn't make any sense to me if a citizen's going to come down here and bid and try to get the lowest bid possible. They shouldn't have an officer of the county bidding against him, especially if he's on duty. And we need to check into that and probably check over with the county commissioners to find out who's in charge of this and try to figure out whether or not that gentleman had any authority to bid up these properties. Like I said, maybe he was doing it as a private citizen. But if you're carrying a gun, You're on duty.
Yeah, and if that was the park ranger.
Yeah, it was the park ranger, Mr. Nielsen.
Uh-huh.
So I think it was A. Nielsen, but don't quote me on his the letter of his first name. But I'm almost positive his last name is Nielsen.
Well, good job, John Foreman. It does look like Nielsen. That was the best shot that we got of his name tag. And it certainly does look like Nielsen, but again, it's a little blurred there on the camera, so we're not sure. We apologize for not covering the entire crowd and everything that was going on, but good job, John Foreman, for spotting that activity, and we'll definitely try to investigate this, but we'll usually run into the same brick walls like we have with Nelda Wells Spears, saying they don't take people's property. And then she wobbles and says they do, and then she says they don't. Basic bureaucratic behavior. They have the power, and they think that we don't. And we don't as long as you people don't get involved.
You're making lies.
I've seen you. This lady right here, she's having her house stolen.
Well, she needs to take it up with someone else.
She has. She's here every week. Every week.
I have a sewer
man. Okay, last question. You say that you're not selling people's homes. You show the foreclosed homes on TV that you're taking. You've shown them on TV.
You're trying to steal my home now, ma'am.
On Channel 17.
Thank
what
you.
About my cameraman? You're trying to steal his house.
Well, he can come to the office and we'll talk about
he
his
can
house.
Come to the office? Ma'am, hey, we're not some type of evil people. Ma'am, and you said that you said that we're a bunch of conspiracy theorists, Sheriff. You know these helicopters are being used, Sheriff. These helicopters are being used for surveillance. You know they're putting flare on them. You admitted it.
Yes, they're putting flare on.
What about the feds? We stopped the Delta Force. What about the Delta Force, Sheriff?
Jones, and I'd ask that you get the microphone out of my face.
You want the microphone out of your face? I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry for trying to report the news.
Of the shed, looking at the old house, you can see the roof is caved in, and that room there totally. And there's the new house. Yavor, death to the new world order.